Good afternoon, sir. We'd like to welcome you to our campus from behalf of the entire IIT Kanpur team. And how was the journey till here? Was it? Do you have?
You know, it was pretty nice actually. It was a short flight from Delhi to Lucknow, and then the drive here was beautiful. So, thank you for having me.
Yes, it's our pleasure, sir. And did you like our campus?
Yeah, it's whatever I have seen so far. It looks very nice.
And sir, you are one of the founders of the most prominent e-commerce marketplaces in India, and hence we invited you to inspire our young minds in the campus. Would you like to say anything to them in particular?
Well, you know, I would just say that, you know, I personally feel India is going through the renaissance of entrepreneurial revolution, startup revolution. I don't think that the way things exist in ecosystem right now, whether it in terms of someone's desire to do something, whether availability of capital, whether it is role models or market opportunities, even government support, right? So there are a lot of things have aligned in my view, and it's a golden era of entrepreneurship. So my message will be that if you have a itch to be an entrepreneur, if you always wanted to do something, this is the best time.
So let's start with the interview then. First, I would like to know, what was your initial team about and how did you work around them and get them all under one roof?
Yeah, see, thing is, you know, I moved to United States in 99, and since then I always wanted to be an entrepreneur, and every 3 months I will have a new business plan, new logo, new name, new PowerPoint, you know, and I'll be very enthusiastic about that. But when it came to doing shop clues, For outsiders, ShopClues is my first venture, but for me it was perhaps 151st. I had already done that 150 times, you know, sometime while driving a car, or sometime while just sleeping, and sometime actually pursuing something. So by the time I did ShopClues, I felt myself quite equipped. You know, this practice makes a man perfect. So it was something like that. Although it's not like I was practicing, I was making an attempt every time. So, you know, but by then I think I had a little bit more wisdom. In a hindsight, that's what I would like to think. So if for team, I wanted to work with a team, you know, where I can assess if they're committed to what I'm doing. Are they enamored by the vision I have? You know, do they have capability? And then, you know, we may start with 2, 3, 4 people team and eventually become thousands. Do they have capacity in terms of headroom that can they grow along with the company? So those were the couple of things I saw. And then I was very clear about, you know, that, you know, vision, capital and team. These are the three things. So I had a very clear vision that the Walmart of India is not going to be Walmart Corporation. It will be an online company, and that online company is going to be a marketplace, not an inventory led model. So when I started ShopClues, actually almost every other company was an inventory led model. So that was kind of vision. And then team, I already mentioned how, you know, how I kind of went about it. And capital wise, you know, I knew that, you know, in my view, does not matter. Capital will always take longer than expected. You will always need more capital than you may have thought. And then it will always take longer than expected. So I ended up raising $2 million from 15 of my friends, moved to this country, and every 6 months we'll raise next round of capital.
So was the transition from US to India as smooth as you expected, or did you face any hurdles?
No, it was full of hurdles. You know, look, India is a land of opportunity now, but also it's a harsh country. You know, it's a harsh country. I remember when I told someone first time that I'm doing ShopClues while still being in Silicon Valley, a friend of mine immediately, same day, he introduced me to an attorney who incorporated ShopClues for me in the US. Another friend of mine on weekend showed up with my house with 6 old laptops. He said, "I know, Sandeep, you have money, but you're becoming entrepreneur. Here are some used laptops. You will need them. Take them." You know, so everyone kind of offered different type of help. But when I came here, honestly, I had to come up with this Murphy Law on steroid list. Anything which can go wrong will go wrong. Anyone who can backstab me will backstab me, etc., etc. I don't want to sound cynical, but honestly, India is very harsh country, right? And although I lived 15 years outside, primarily in Silicon Valley, and every year I will come to India. But when I came first time for ShopClues with a one-way ticket back from United States, India smelled different. India sounded different. Everything was so different, right? But you know, I'm glad I had to go through that. You know, while I grew up in this country, when I started ShopClues, honestly, for all practical purpose, India was like a foreign country for me. But you know, I when I look back, I get very excited. Actually, I had, you know, as to answer your question, there were all sort of ups and downs, but I really enjoyed that whole process.
And sir, the thing about backstabbing thing, do you think that backstabbing and this level of competitiveness would only make India better country, or
yeah,
sort of
see, look,
people would compete further,
you
more
know,
and
you know,
put
yeah.
in more effort?
See, that's a very nice question. See, I feel, you know, whether it is backstabbing, whether something has to go wrong and will go wrong. See, all these are can be names. In my view, when you be, when you choose to become an entrepreneur, then you also choose to point finger to yourself rather than pointing finger to others. You know, it does not matter why you did not make it. You can have a great story that here are the 7 reasons why I did not make it. But guess what? It is a still story about you did not make it. Right? So I personally feel that, you know, while someone should be, you know, I think, you know, I feel very passionate about people should try, should not be afraid of failure, etc. But my point is, you know, in startup, nothing goes straight line. Right? And then, you know, rather than having a long list of things which did not go out, did not go right, and blaming others, you know, you can still be, you know, it is after the facts, right? So what you have in your hand is really you as entrepreneur, how you can make an impact, how you can make a difference. And see, I remember in 2004 and 5, I used to work with Microsoft in their corporate headquarters in Redmond, Washington, and in fact had an opportunity and privilege to work very closely with Bill Gates and Steve Ballmer. And that time, you know, we would focus a lot about which are the world's largest SME countries. So like USA that time had 25 million SMEs, China had 25, 30 million. India, if you think about it, is the home of SMEs. There are 40 million SMEs in this country. And out of those, in my view, half sell something for a living. Like they are traders, retailers, wholesalers, right? So I thought, you know, most of these SMEs, they did not have deep pockets. They did not know English. They did not know technology. And I said, as India goes from 8% organized retail to a larger percentage of organized retail, and you see Walmart, Carrefour, Tesco, and large companies coming here, what will happen to these 20 million SMEs? Not everyone will work in Walmart or Tesco and make a meaningful sense. Some of them may not be trained. Some of them, it may be a step down. So I thought, wouldn't it be great that right now, as India goes through the organized retail revolution, they all are sitting on sidelines. How about I create a platform where a bit of technology, bit of English, and bit of MBA is given to them through a distributed marketplace platform. So that was the whole idea. And so I created a platform where I thought, so long as you can read and barely read and write in English and can send and receive email in terms of technological sophistication, you can now sell online. And my idea was that I will have each seller, SME seller, who is inch wide, mile deep, who can source one product at a price, at a selection better than you and I can ever do, right? But that's what they do for a living. And then when they use our platform, which will offer them technology, supply chain management, catalog, marketing, and many other services, it's a very complementary combination. So that's how we started.
And sir, if my stats are not wrong, it was in Jan 2011 when the idea of an e-commerce marketplace struck you. So how did you went about materializing that idea?
Yeah. See, actually, to be honest, I first time ever thought about an idea called Clues Network in actually September of 2007. And that time I pitched Sequoia, Sierra Venture, and many other venture capital firm in Silicon Valley about this whole idea of Clues Network. Within that, I had shop clues, fashion clues, deal clues, many admission clues, investment clues. I had this travel clues. So I had this whole 100 clues and then clues, and that's why company, hence the company was called Clues Network. So that was the first time I ever, you know, I was working on Wall Street. I was very deeply involved with internet, but I had not really taken a very deep plunge into entrepreneurism. That's what I started pitching to some of these VCs I just mentioned. But then in 2008, the financial meltdown happened in US, Lehman Brothers failed. For next 2 years, there was no capital available for any new business idea. Existing companies were either failing, some were becoming profitable, and some were still managed to get money. So and then during that time, my Wall Street career was on the rise. So I thought, let me just put this on hold. And also as an immigrant to US, always had a, you know, some kind of controlled risk appetite because of visa situation and monetary situation and so on. So anyhow, it was actually in October 2010 when Make My Trip went public in August 2010. I, as an analyst, decided to provide a research coverage on Make My Trip. And during that time, I came here and wrote a research report on India internet. And that time I realized that while e-commerce is 17-year-old industry, that time, for all practical purpose, it was new to India. And secondly, all the Indian e-commerce companies were inventory-led. Third, they spent very wastefully a lot of money on marketing. So I thought, wouldn't it be nice to create a first marketplace in this country? And I had a like very high exit barrier. I was making $1 million as an analyst. I was very high profile analyst. I used to be on CNBC, Fox, ABC News every day, and covering companies like Google, Yahoo, Amazon, eBay, Expedia, Priceline, meeting Mark Zuckerberg, Steve Jobs for a living, right? So it was pretty nice job. So, you know, leaving that, leaving $1 million, leaving US and being in Gurgaon, you know, it was a big thing. But anyhow, so I took that plunge. I remember it was 10-10-10. It was the 10th October 2010 when I said, the regret of not doing ShopClues will be bigger than anything I give up.
And sir, how do you, there are Flipkart, Amazon, Snapdeal. So what sets you apart? Is there a particular thing which you...
See, when we started at the time of launch, couple of things I would like to mention. A, on record, we are the first managed marketplace in India. Before that, there was only eBay India, which was an opaque marketplace, which did not have skin in the game. So they did not care about the fulfillment experience, did not care about the return policy, did not provide anything else. So we became the first managed marketplace in India. That time, Flipkart was an inventory-led model. There was no Amazon, and Snapdeal almost behaved like a Groupon, more of a group buying. That's what the market was. And we were the 35th entrant into Indian e-commerce. Within first 7-8 months, we became the fourth largest, a ranking which company maintain even now. So at the time of launch, the biggest thing was we were the first managed marketplace. We cater to SME sellers. And then, you know, as an analyst, I was very closely involved with eBay, Amazon, and many other e-commerce company. And I always knew that Amazon has a slightly weaker hand when it comes to non-standard categories such as clothing, shoes, accessories, health and beauty, jewelry and watches. But they were very good in books, electronic, computer and mobile. So from the day one, I wanted ShopClues to focus on non-standard categories. Because I never forgot that one day Amazon would be operating in this country. So one was first managed marketplace, second one was non-standard category, third was SME, fourth was, I said, how about within each category? Like within the perfume category, you can buy a 300 rupees perfume, you can also buy a 8,000 rupees perfume. So we operated more in a 300 to 800 rupees perfume category, right? Because there's a market for that. So that's how we kind of managed, and that was a vision, and that's how we operated. And honestly, right from, and another thing which we did is our cost structure. Our cost structure was so different that a lot of investors would come and think that I'm probably missing 10. They thought that maybe I don't have accuracy of numbers. Another thing I never liked about Indian e-commerce when I started was cash on delivery. I thought, see, first of all, I realized that in India, people thought e-commerce is a very profitable business, which is completely incorrect. E-commerce, even at scale, can hardly make money, right? So, and then I thought, if cash on delivery is 80-90% of Indian e-commerce, and 30% of cash on delivery items will come back, and there will be 1/3 chances once they come back, they are not in the same condition as they were sold, how can you make money? So I was the first company who said, we will, while, you know, jaisa desh vaisa bhesh, so there's no way, I could not say no to COD, but I said, we will give something called Clues Bucks. We will give it only if you are buying prepaid. So we kind of, you know, so we, and then we had a lot of these deals. We had Sunday flea market, jaw dropping deal, outrageous deal. These were some of the deals where we created tsunami of traffic. None of those deals were available with cash on delivery. They were only available through prepaid, right? So when we launched, a year after that, national average of cash on delivery in India was 80%. And for ShopClues, it was 8%. So these were the few things, just basically focus on SME, non-standard items, manage marketplace, right? And also one thing, I know I gave a very long answer to your question, but one thing more, ShopClues became the first marketplace in the world which offered fulfillment as a service from day one. So if you look at Amazon for first 8-9 years was inventory-led model and then started adding some categories with marketplace. eBay was always a marketplace. Alibaba was always a marketplace. And Alibaba, in fact, only 7-8 years back decided that fulfillment is very important and they would spend billions of dollars to build fulfillment. We were the first marketplace literally on earth to create fulfillment as a service for a small and medium sellers from day one. So all those things I think paid off. Otherwise, I don't think India needed us or we were very late. You know, we were quite late in terms of entering into the e-commerce.
So sir, being an angel investor, what domain do you think at present has a good scope for startups in India?
See, I'll be honest with you. Look, India missed the industrial revolution in 1740. India missed one by one, whether it is automobile, whether it is paper, steel, and then semiconductor, and then hardware, software, internet, solar, artificial intelligence. There's so many revolutions we have missed. But that is a glass half empty. But glass half full is, in almost every domain, there's an opportunity here, right? So in my view, in India, there's an opportunity in every domain. But you know, I don't want to be jack of all trade and master of none. So I understand consumer internet, I understand digital economies. That's where I like to invest. So within that, and again, I would say that to large extent, whenever we talk about entrepreneurship and startup, I would say there's a very large overlap between that plus the digital economy, right? I have a very soft corner for marketplaces. It can be marketplace for anything, right? But marketplaces, and very happy since I started ShopClues until now, at least 15 different verticals where at least there's one sizable marketplace which operate in India. I like fintech, I like edutech, I like health tech, right? I also like some of these newer technologies in terms of virtual reality, artificial intelligence, but I still feel a lot of things have to happen for those newer technologies to have a mass market adoption and commercialization. So I'm like literally still more, a little bit more in the mainstream opportunities, and I invest in an early stage. Whenever I'm impressed by the energies and passion of our entrepreneur, for me, that's an investment I want to make.
So you have worked for some years at Silicon Valley, I guess. So could you tell us a bit more about your work and experience at Silicon Valley?
Yeah. I actually worked for several years. I graduated with my MBA program in 2001, and I, started working on ShopClues in October 2010. That was still moonlighting, and launched in August. Like, I moved to India in August 2011. So almost a decade, I worked with four Fortune 100 companies in their headquarters in the United States, and in many places, I was very fortunate to work with some of the well-known legendary founders. So overall, I would say, there's an old Silicon Valley saying that if you have not seen scale, you cannot create scalable business. So I was very fortunate to work with some of the largest companies in their own categories, like Microsoft, the largest software company, yeah. Charles Schwab, the largest online stock broker company, right? Citigroup, the largest commercial bank. So I was very fortunate to work with some of these companies, and the kind of scale I saw really was very fascinating. And especially most fascinating was honestly working with Microsoft in their headquarters in Redmond, Washington. I used to work with Windows Vista. Before that, some of the low price point SKUs for Windows for China or Thailand. And working on a product which you now realize can be rolled out to 200 million people. Like, you roll out and 3 months from now, it'll be available to 200 million people was very fascinating. So I think working in all these companies, and then, I remember when I worked first job out of my business school was Charles Schwab. That time, you have a chip on the shoulder, you have a fresh MBA degree, you want to use it every day. And I used to think that when I worked there, I thought I did not even need MBA degree to work here. This company is beneath me. I'm not learning much, etc. But honestly, when I started ShopClues, the highest learning on a day-to-day basis, which will come handy to me, was what I learned at Charles Schwab. So my only thing I would say is that you learn from everything, but you don't realize that learning become inseparable from you, and it becomes very handy in different situations. So when I started working as an entrepreneur, I realized so many things for which I took for granted, and I had a sense of entitlement that this is available to everyone, but I think they were very useful when I became as an entrepreneur.
So your journey to the success is very inspiring, and we all adore you and respect you. So what was your initial team like, and the first hurdles which you had to face? Was there a particular someone who always helped you to motivate you and take you out of your gloomy days?
As I mentioned, I was very fortunate to be in Silicon Valley at a time where I could make a very meaningful sense. Silicon Valley is the mecca for technology. So that was one thing. It was Silicon Valley where honestly, almost every third person has a day job and a business plan in an armpit. So, that racket's very contagious. It's very contagious. Every third person, honestly, has, you know, you go to any, you know, you go to Diwali party, you go to New Year party, you go to Halloween party, you go to any party and you meet everyone who has a fantastic job, very accomplished person, but they always have a desire to be an entrepreneur. So one, that became a source of inspiration for me. Second is, honestly, I don't know how it happens to you, but every time I would read autobiography or biography of anyone, I honestly, last 50 page, rather than finishing the book, I would like feel like throwing the book and now starting on my own. I will feel very motivated whenever I read about all these entrepreneurs. So that was another thing. And then, you know, I think, you know, over time, because I did a lot of iterations, you know, I kept on kind of growing. In terms of when I thought about Shop Clues, I actually got $1.6 million lined up from some of my friends. And a very famous VC came and he told me that, why are you raising this small money? I'll give you 5 million at a higher valuation, etc., etc. And I spent some cycles with him and ultimately got rejection. And you know, so in a hindsight, if I look at from the first time I ever articulated Clues Network and Shop Clues in September 2007 until I actually ended up doing it, I actually got roughly 30 rejections. And, you know, I think, you know, a lot of people don't realize, they think, you know, everyone knows that money raising is difficult, but they don't realize that, you know, they're like, I know in being in Silicon Valley, these things were very famous. Google got rejected by 31 venture capitalists who now shoot down their own, you know, they feel like shooting down themselves because, you know, they could have got the world's one of the best return. So, you know, money was one of the big hurdles. Inspiration wise, I mentioned to you, these were various sources which caused variation, like a source of inspiration for me.
And in particular, someone who always helped you out of.
See, there were many people. There were many people. Honestly, there was one person. In fact, he's from India. He grew up in Jaipur. He's much senior to me. He founded one company which at peak was almost a $5 billion company. His name is Mr. Naren Bakshi. So I'm not sure from which he's also a product from one of the IITs, I do not know. Then he, in his early 70s, he went to Stanford and founded one very well-known software company. So when I was becoming entrepreneur, I always had this question that, you know, when do I know I'm ready? I have $1 million job, I'm the only bread earner, this and that, should I give up my job? And he would actually, in Silicon Valley, one thing is very good is people are generally very, very, very helpful because they know that at some point of their time, if they have something to give, they also know that at some point of time they had something to take also, so they want to give back. So anyhow, so this person played a huge role in my kind of shaping up as an entrepreneur. And then in terms of team, you know, I had 3-4 team members whom I actually convinced to move along with me from Silicon Valley to come to India to start Shop Clues. And one of them was that time my spouse, and another was someone whom I knew as a friend. And in fact, another person was also a friend of mine who worked with another technology companies. So, but I happened to spend, you know, 6 months or more with each team member before I kind of decided to team up with them. And, you know, I had seen for many years, a lot of Indians would try to start a company, sometime India focused out of Silicon Valley, but they will never be able to take a plunge in terms of moving to India permanently or convincing other team members to move to India. But I put one condition for my all team members is that, you know, if you are creating a consumer internet company for India, which we were creating with Shop Clues, you must move to India. There's no way you can be, you know, living in Silicon Valley and visit India for a few months, which a lot of people have as a kind of, you know, impractical dream. So
I've heard it quite a lot of times that, you know, Silicon Valley is such a brilliant atmosphere for, you know, starting up or coming out of the, you know, well. Is there something we can do to, you know, establish such atmosphere in our country also, so that, you know, we don't have to go outside to establish ourselves and we can make the whole thing here?
See, it's a great question. I think that what you asked, I think in my view, that momentum has already started a few years back. See, you also have to see, that's why I was mentioning earlier that, you know, from 1740 onwards, the Western economies went through the Industrial Revolution, which created a lot of great inventors, which created very scalable company from the use of basic fundas of mechanical engineering to creating a very scalable business. A lot of things happened, which we missed in this country. right? And then also the new age digital, like new digital type of startup revolution, you know, that happened in Silicon Valley in 1956 when Tom Perkins graduated from Stanford University. He used to date this author called Daniel Steele, which is a very famous fiction writer. And he happened to meet two people outside Stanford University called Hewlett and Packard. So Tom became Tom Perkins, which he founded Kleiner Perkins, one of the largest VC fund, and Hewlett Packard ended up founding HP. So, you know, so what I'm trying to say is it was 1956 when what you are asking me started in United States. So it still took so many decades for Silicon Valley to reach where it is. In fact, if I see, I landed in this country in August 2011, until now, it's been only 6 years. And I think so much has happened in this country. So I feel that, you know, just the fact we are having this discussion, just the fact, you know, I go to a lot of institutes, educational institutes in this country. I see almost everyone want to be now entrepreneur. You know, no offense to any, these all are great companies, but no longer people I want to work with Infosys, Tata Motor, Axis Bank and Citibank. They want to pursue some on their own dream. No longer a peer pressure that, oh, that guy, you know, my score, my JE score was higher than him, I did better than him, and he's making 18 lakh rupees and I'm without job and I'm pursuing something. And what will happen if I'm going to get married, my parents are going to feel, you know, why I'm not making money, right? All those things we have shed off, right? When I came in this country, I'll be honest with you, I had a hard time hiring for shop clues, because people will say, Sandeep, I really like what you talk about it. It looks very fascinating to me. But you know, 6 months from now, I'm getting married. I don't have a heart to tell my future father-in-law that I'm working with this company called ShopClues, which he never heard about, right? Now everyone wants to be with the, you know. So my point is, I think that revolution is happening, but I have a short list of the things which we should do. One is, failure should be celebratory. Right, rather than judging that person, you know, in my view, I think, you know, we cricket is so famous in this country that we always take cricket example. I'm going to take a baseball example, that the moment you say I'm going to be entrepreneur and I'm going to give up anything, but I don't care, but regret of not doing this will be bigger than anything I give up, I think you have hit the home run, and after that nobody can make you out, right? You just have to touch all the post, even you are struggling and dying and falling, does not matter, right? You hit the home. The moment you say I'm going to do this and you actually do it, I think you have to hit the home run. We should realize that as a society. Second is local heroes. Look, I come from a generation where India still had four type of local heroes. One was cricketers, one were the Bollywood people, third one the politicians, and fourth one was a businessman. But those businessmen, not Deep Kalra, not Sachin Bansal, not Kunal Behal, but the businessmen who were born with a silver spoon in their mouth, and their last names used to be Tata and Birlas, right? So business always looks privileged, right? But now what is happening, this country has produced a lot of local heroes, and what are the two, three things common in those local heroes? A, they all come from a typical middle class background, which you and I come from. They all chose education and cerebral status quo and do something on their own. Right. And so in what has happened in last 6 years, we have produced, like the example I was giving you of Tom Perkins and Hewlett and Packard, this country has now produced, in my view, 100 to 200 heroes, local heroes, whom we can relate to, that, oh, this he also went to modern school in Delhi. Oh, he went to that IIT. Oh, if he can do it, I think I can also do it. You know, we don't realize just the, you know, I personally feel so long as a human can get a person, can an exposure that this is possible, human resilience is so strong that they then make it possible, right? So my point is, failure should be celebratory, which is just society is changing. Second is, you know, this country has produced a lot of local heroes. Third is, you know, in the past, there were only 2-3 venture capitalists and 8 or 9 angel investors. Now this country has probably 50 to 100 venture capital firms and maybe a few thousand angel investors. Government, right? Government, by the way, in any country, has tendency to kill anything which start working. But fortunately, in this country, government is very encouraging right now, at least for the startup, right? So accessibility of capital is growing up, local heroes are going up, failure is okay, government policies are supporting. Rest is what you do, you know, like now, you know, so I, you know, but I, you know, I feel that this momentum is very, very big, right? Last thing I on this topic, I'll say that India accounted for 35% of global GDP until 1650, and it came down to only 2% by 2000, Right? Right now, we are 4 to 5% of global GDP. In my view, entrepreneurship can take this country back to 15-20% of global GDP by 2025.
So. Okay.